Okay, let's pray together. Father, we're just grateful today for your blessings. Thank you so much for the joy of knowing you as our personal Savior. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege of singing about your wonderful resurrection. We know, Lord, that we would not have a gospel to preach if we didn't have the resurrection of the Savior. Lord, we thank you that you came out of the grave on that first Lord's Day morning. And we celebrate that every Lord's Day and throughout the week as we think about your glorious resurrection. I pray, Lord, you'd speak to our hearts now as we open the Word of God and talk about the blood of our Savior. We pray, Lord, if there's some in our midst, and I'm sure there are, some who need to come to Christ and be saved today, I pray that your Holy Spirit would touch their hearts and that they would come to Jesus this morning and give an eternal yes to the shed blood of the Savior. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Hebrews 9:22, one verse of scripture as we begin this morning. Hebrews 9 and verse 22. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of blood there is no remission of sins. Perhaps the greatest preacher that Southern Baptists have known in the 20th century was W.A. Creswell, pastor of the First Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas. A great pastor and a great theologian, a scholar, and a great Christian. Here's what he said. When we preach the cross, when we preach the blood, when we preach the sacrificial death of Christ, we're preaching the meaning of his coming into the world. The sacrifice of Christ consummated the great redemptive plan and purpose of God in the earth. This is the scarlet thread through the ages. On one New Year's Eve, Dr. Creswell had always complained through the years that he didn't have time to finish his sermons. So they told him one New Year's Eve, you take all the time you want. So Dr. Creswell preached 4 hours on that New Year's Eve, and he preached the subject of the scarlet thread through the Bible. And then they later put it into a book. Well, the Bible is a book about the blood. And sometimes we're accused of preaching a gospel of blood. And of course, we proudly plead guilty to the charge. The blood is the very power and life of the gospel. But many don't want to hear about the blood. They don't want to hear a gospel of the blood of Christ. But if you take the blood out of the gospel, you don't have any gospel. Because all in the New Testament, all through the Old Testament, from the beginning of Genesis, all the way through the end of the Revelation, there is the scarlet thread. It is the blood of Jesus. That's what the Bible is about. It's about the blood of the Savior. Now, how did the blood atonement originate? Well, the blood atonement was planned in the heart and mind of God before the foundation of the world. I want you to just turn back in your Bibles there to to 1 Peter chapter 1. I'll read a couple of verses with you. 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning verse 19. But with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world. And then you go back to the book of Hebrews, Hebrews 9:26. It says that he suffered since the foundation of the world. Now, the word foundation means to fix firmly. So the blood of Jesus, the crucifixion of Jesus, the death of the Savior, and the shed blood of the Savior was fixed firmly before the foundation of the world. Before man was created, before the world was created, it was fixed firmly in the heart and mind of God. Now, the blood atonement was first applied in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve was in the Garden of Eden. They sinned, and they were disobedient to God, and they realized that they were naked. And the Bible tells us that they took fig leaves and made them aprons so that they could hide themselves. Now, this is man's first self-righteous attempt to provide a covering for his sins. This is a type of works for salvation. They were trying to cover their sins. But notice what Jesus did. Jesus took coats of skin to clothe them. The animal was killed. The animal had to die in order for him to have the coats of skin. So he took the coats of skin and covered them. This is the first example of innocent blood being shed for the guilty. Now you note here that we're beginning in the very first part of the Bible. Now how was the blood atonement perpetuated? We know how the blood atonement began in the heart and mind of God before the foundation of the world, but how was the blood atonement perpetuated? Well, the blood atonement was perpetuated through the sacrifices of the Old Testament. And the first one I want to mention is mentioned in Genesis chapter 4. And you're familiar with Cain and Abel. Cain and Abel were the sons of Adam and Eve. And you know the lifelong question, where did Cain get his wife? I remember somebody asking Dr. R.G. Lee, where did Cain get his wife? And he said, I have no idea, but if she was all right for Cain, if he was happy with her, it's fine with me. But we know that Cain and Abel were the first sons of Adam and Eve. Well, they came to make an offering to the Lord. Now, Cain made an offering from the labor of his own hands, and Abel honored God by giving an offering of blood from the lamb of his flock. Now, God rejected Cain's offering, but he accepted Abel's offering. Now, why did he reject Cain's offering and accept Abel's offering? Because Abel's offering was an offering of blood. It was a blood sacrifice, and God accepted the blood sacrifice. And again, we have here in Cain offering something that was from his own hands, the works of his hands, another example of works for salvation. You see, from the very beginning, man has tried to come up with a new way, a different way to have the blood atonement, but there is only one way. And then, of course, we move into the New Testament. We see the Passover in the book of Exodus, chapter 12. You know the story there. The Israelite people were in Egyptian slavery, and a king had come to throne that did not know Joseph. And did not know the prestige that Joseph had gained in the land of Egypt. So the Israelite people were increasing in number. They were becoming a threat to the king. So they were being oppressed. They were being persecuted. And God raised up Moses to lead them out of Egyptian physical slavery. And as you know, Moses went to the Pharaoh and began to request that the Israelite people be released. And the Pharaoh rejected that. He would not let them go. God sent 10 plagues on the Egyptian people, and the 10th one was the one of the blood. You remember what happened. Listen to what the scripture says. Exodus 12 and 12, "For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and I will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment, for I am the Lord." He said through Moses and Aaron, he said to those Egyptian people, I'm going to move through this land, and the firstborn of man and the firstborn of beast are going to be put to death. But he made provision for the Israelite people. He said to the Israelite people, here's what I want you to do. You take a lamb and you kill that lamb. You take the blood and you put it on each side of the doorpost and at the top. And when I come through the land, I see the blood, I will pass over you. And that awful night in Egypt, can you imagine what happened that night? Here's an Egyptian home. The firstborn of man died, and the firstborn of the beast died. But here's an Israelite home. He saw the blood on the doorpost, and he passed over them. I'll tell you, my friends, the blood of Jesus needs to be on the doorpost of your soul. And if it's not on the doorpost of your soul, the judgment of God will not pass over you. But if the blood of Jesus is on the doorpost of your soul, the judgment of God will pass over you. So we have the Passover. But I want you to note something about the Passover. It was not the blood flowing in the veins of the animal that was sufficient. It was the blood shed and applied that God was looking for. So we have Cain and Abel's offering, we have the Passover, but then there's the priesthood. This system of blood sacrifice was practiced throughout the priesthood. Under the Levitical system, the priest would lay their hands on the head of a sacrificial animal, and the animal would be killed, and the blood would be shed, and the blood would be shed and sprinkled on the altar, on the mercy seat, in the Holy of Holies. The priest would go into the Holy of Holies and go behind the veil. It's interesting that when Jesus said on the cross, "It is finished," when he died, the veil in the temple was rent from top to bottom. So you see, before then, the priest would go into the Holy of Holies, and he would take that blood of the animal, and he would cast it onto the mercy seat. He would plead the forgiveness of himself and the forgiveness of the people, and that had to be rolled over. Every year, that had to be done. But when Jesus Christ died on the cross of Calvary, the veil of the temple was rent, signifying that no longer would that be necessary because Jesus paid the supreme sacrifice on the cross. But I want you to note something here. In Leviticus 17:11, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that makes an atonement for the soul." Note this. It was not the blood flowing in the veins of the sacrifice that made the atonement. It was the blood that was shed. It was the blood that was sprinkled and applied that counted with God. You see, the sacrifice of the innocent for the benefit of the guilty runs throughout the Old Testament, and it's pointing to the supreme sacrifice of the shed blood of the Lamb at Calvary. The blood atonement. The blood atonement was not only perpetuated through the Old Testament sacrifices, but the blood atonement was perpetuated through the preaching of the prophets. You go to the book of Isaiah, and you look at Isaiah chapter 53, and there you have a description of the crucifixion of Jesus. He says, "He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. Our chastisement was laid upon him." It is a description of the shed blood of God, the shed blood of the Lord Jesus. And as Isaiah wrote that, he describes it as though he were sitting right there at the foot of the cross. But really, it was 700 years before Jesus came and died on the cross. What's happening here? The blood sacrifices, the blood atonement is being perpetuated through the preaching of the prophets. And then Daniel, who is known as the Paul of the Old Testament, Daniel in chapter 9, in verse 26, talks about how that the Messiah will be cut off. He's talking about the crucifixion of Jesus on the cross. And then you go to David. David spoke of the suffering of Jesus in Psalms 23. You need to be familiar with Psalms 23 because Psalms 23 is a beautiful, beautiful description of Jesus' death on the cross. In fact, the very first verse says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Jesus made that statement on the cross. When God the Father turned his back upon the Son, Jesus said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" This is David speaking. Now, what's David doing here? David writes this in the first person. He never experienced anything like this. What's going on here? Well, I'll tell you what's going on. He's writing it in the first person because he's writing it as though he is standing or sitting right by the cross. And then in verses 6, 7, and 8, he talks about how that Jesus was mocked on the cross. And then in verse 14, "My strength is gone," how that the strength of his body was evaporated out. And then in verse 16, it says, "They pierced my hands and my feet." In verse 18, "They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture." That's just one example of the psalmist writing concerning the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the manner of perpetuating the blood atonement all the way through the New Testament until we come to, all the way through the Old Testament until we come to the New Testament. And then the third thing, the blood atonement culminated in Jesus Christ. The culmination is seen in the crucifixion in John chapter 19 and other accounts in the Gospels of the crucifixion of Jesus. Now at Calvary, at Calvary there were three crosses. I know several times you will see, or many times you will see, crosses. There'll be three crosses signifying that Jesus died. He died on the center cross, but there was two other crosses, one on his right and one on his left. And these criminals died on these crosses. Well, they broke the legs of the first man, and they broke the legs of the second man. Now, they did this to speed up the death, so that they wouldn't be out there past a certain time. They started to break the legs of Jesus, but he was already dead. Now, if Jesus is already dead, why didn't they just leave him alone? Why didn't they just walk on away and say, Jesus is dead. We don't have to worry about that. We're not going to break his bones, because they didn't know it, but they were fulfilling Old Testament scripture where it says that his bones will not be broken. So they just they could have just stopped there and left him alone. He was already dead, but what did they do? What did they do? You know, some teach that we are saved by Jesus giving his life. No, the blood sacrifices of the Old Testament teach us that this is not enough. So what did they do? They pierced his side. Why did they pierce his side? He was already dead. Why did they pierce his side? I'll tell you why. Because when they pierced his side, the blood and water flowed from his body. The blood was not allowed to stay in the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. That's the reason right there. It's the shed blood of Jesus. The shed blood of the Savior that flowed from his body that was the sacrifice for our sins. And not only that, but the culmination is not only seen in the shed blood of Christ on the cross, but the culmination of the blood atonement is seen in the resurrection. In John chapter 20, verses 14 through 17, we have the appearances of Jesus, one of the appearances of Jesus to Mary Magdalene. And do you remember what Jesus said to Mary Magdalene? She said, "For I am not yet ascended to my Father. Touch me not, for I have not ascended to my Father." Now, what's meant by the statement that Jesus made? Well, Jesus was fulfilling his role as a high priest on the Day of Atonement. The word translated ascended, because of the verb tense of the word, suggests that Jesus was in the process of ascending when he appeared to Mary. Now, when the priest had offered sacrifices, he would officially present the blood before God at the mercy seat in the Holy of Holies. Now, Hebrews tells us, now listen carefully, Hebrews tells us that Jesus Christ became our high priest. It's clear to me that Christ, after he met Mary, actually did ascend into heaven and presented his blood at the throne of God, and that his blood turned the judgment seat into the mercy seat, which it is today. That's the meaning of the statement when Jesus said, "Touch me not, because I have not ascended to my Father." In some manner, the Lord Jesus Christ, even at that moment, was in the process of going to the very throne of God in heaven and presenting his blood on the altar, where it will be there. I believe it will be there, remain there throughout all eternity, as an eternal testimony of the price that he paid for our sins. Amen and amen. Now, when the disciples saw him, they thought they were seeing a ghost. I would too, wouldn't you? They thought they were seeing a ghost. And Jesus invited them to handle him and see for sure that it was Jesus. Then Jesus said, "A spirit hath not flesh and bones, as you see that I have." Now, you remember Thomas. Thomas didn't believe the other apostles. They told him that Jesus has arisen, that he's alive. And Thomas didn't believe that. He said, "I'm not going to believe that till I see the nail scars in his hand, Did I see the nail prints in his hands? I'm not going to believe that Jesus Christ is alive. And later on you will note that he did see Jesus, and he saw the nail scars in his hands, and he recognized that it was the risen Savior. Fanny Crosby heard of a man in Chicago claiming to be the Messiah. You're familiar with Fanny Crosby, wrote many of our songs that we sing from our hymn book. And she was always very disturbed when she heard somebody claiming to be the Messiah. So she heard that this man in Chicago was claiming to be the Messiah. So she decided to write a song and dedicate it to the Salvation Army. So she did that. She wrote that song, wrote a song, dedicated it to the Salvation Army. And then she heard also that this false Messiah and his followers were going to be walking down the street, a certain street in Chicago. She decided to go there. So she went there and joined herself to the Salvation Army band. And they decided to sing the song that Fanny Crosby had written in their honor and dedicated to them. And so here's what happened. This false Messiah was and his followers going down one side of the street, and the Salvation Army band coming down the other side of the street, going in a different direction. And when they got near, when the Salvation Army band got near the false Christ and his followers, they started singing that song that Fanny Crosby had written and dedicated to the Salvation Army. And here's what it was. I shall know him, I shall know him by the scars in his hands, the nail prints in his hands. So they heard that. Those people heard that, that was following this false Christ. One guy broke ranks, and he ran out and ran ahead and got in front of that false Messiah. And he said, let me see your hands. And let me see your hands. He looked at his hands and he said, there's no scars. There's no scars. The Salvation Army band says that we will know him by the scars in his hands, the nail prints in his hands. There's no scars. There's no nail prints in the hands. He said, you're a false Messiah. And all at once, all those people that was following that false Messiah, they went across the street and joined that Salvation Army band and started singing, I shall know him. I shall know him by the nail prints in his hands. Listen, my friends, when I get to heaven, I'm not going to have a blemish in my body. There won't be any scars. I've got a scar up here that I received when I was in grammar school. My cousin tripped me, and I fell into the stage and had a gash there. And then I've got a scar down here under my chin that my other cousin jumped off the end of the seesaw, and I went down and hit my chin. I've got scars on my body. But when I get to heaven, my friends, there won't be any scars on my body, and there won't be any scars on your body. We'll have a perfect body like that of the Lord Jesus Christ. But let me tell you, the one in heaven that will have the scars and have the nail prints in the hand is that of the Lord Jesus Christ. All in eternity, he will wear those scars. He'll wear those nail prints to remind us of his death at Calvary and the crucifixion of the that was paid for us and the blood that was shed that we could have eternal life. Amen. Now, why did Jesus say flesh and bones instead of flesh and blood? Well, first, his blood had to be shed. His glorified, resurrected, spiritual body did not require blood for its life. His life was the very life of God in himself. Now, when we receive our resurrected, glorified spiritual body, we won't need blood for life. We will have the very life of God himself flowing through us and energizing us throughout all eternity. So the culmination of the blood atonement was in the death of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus. Now, why is the blood of Jesus so necessary? It's necessary because we're sinners, because we sin. We cannot redeem ourselves. Sinful man is in bondage to the world, the flesh, and the devil. Sinful man cannot enter into heaven. Sin has to be dealt with. God does not overlook sin. And there's a price to be paid for sin. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. It was necessary for Jesus to die and had shed his blood on the cross to satisfy the holy wrath of God because we are sinners. And it was necessary because of the benefits given to the believer. I'll tell you, if you're a child of God, you can shout right here because of the benefits that's given to the believer. First of all, without the shedding of blood, there is no justification. You think about all the sin in your life. You think about those bad thoughts and those evil thoughts. And you think about the things that you've done that you know is wrong, that you know that you have sinned. The Bible says because Jesus Christ shed his blood, we are justified. We're not only forgiven and stand before God just as if we had never sinned, but we are declared innocent because Jesus Christ shed his blood. So without the shedding of blood, there is no justification. And without the shedding of blood, there is no redemption. There's no propitiation. Propitiation means paid in full. When Jesus died on the cross, he said, "It is finished. It's finished." Greatest words that there is in the Bible. It is finished. What is finished? The redemption plan is finished. We have propitiation and we have redemption and we have forgiveness of all of our sins. Listen, without the shedding of blood, you cannot have forgiveness of all your sins. The Bible says that the blood of Jesus covers all of our sins, our past sins, our present sins, and our future sins. They're all under the blood of Jesus. When you believe, when you trust, when you accept, when you appropriate the blood of Jesus to your heart and your life, all of your sins are forgiven. Because when Jesus died on the cross, he died for all of our sins. Name me one sin that Jesus did not die for. Name me one sin that Jesus did not shed his blood for. When he died, he paid the price for all of our sins. Without the shedding of blood, there is no cleansing from sin. 1 John 1:7, the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. And without the shedding of blood, there's no victory over the devil. And listen, without the shedding of blood of the Lord Jesus, there's no home in heaven for any of us. When Jesus died and shed his blood, he made it possible for us to go to heaven. Amen. Now, what happened at Calvary? I'll tell you what happened at Calvary. Substitution. Substitution. In 1 Peter chapter 2, in verse 24, who his own self bear our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed. Substitution. That's what happened. Substitution. It was our place. It was our place to receive the crown of thorns. It was our place to receive the scourger's whip. It was our place to receive the pierced side. It was our place to be nailed to the cross. But Jesus paid the price for us. Substitution, that's what it's about. Jesus paying the price for our sins. The next time you hear somebody say, "I believe we can get to heaven by doing good. I believe we can get to heaven by loving everybody and being kind and helping others," ask yourself the question, where does the blood fit in on this? Where does the blood fit in? In Ephesians 1:18 or 1 Peter 1:18, "For as much as we know that we were not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by the tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ." We're not saved by something we do or something we don't do. We're not saved by doing good. We're saved when we receive the blood atonement into our hearts, into our lives. The blood of Jesus is the only way of redemption. Hebrews 9:22 says, "Without the shedding of blood, There is no forgiveness, no remission. Back when churches used to debate religion, probably don't remember that. I don't remember it, but I guess when I was really small, they were still doing that. They were having a debate on how to be saved at this particular church. And they had various different groups that were there to represent various ways that they believed that a person can go to heaven. And the service started, the building was filled, and the first man got up and said, "The way to be saved is to live right." And he presented his case and sat down. And the next man got up, next preacher got up and said, "No," says, "he didn't go far enough. You've got to join the church. You got to live right, but you got to join the church." He presented his case and he sat down. And the next preacher got up and said, "No, they're both wrong. They didn't go far enough. You got to live right, you got to join the church, you got to be baptized in order to be saved." And the other one got up. The next man got up and said, "Well, these four brothers before me, they didn't go far enough. You've got to live right. You've got to join the church. You've got to be baptized. You've got to do good works." And he presented his position on his idea of how that you're saved and how that you go to heaven. And he sat down. At about that time, there was an older preacher that got up in the back of the house and started to shuffle his way toward the pulpit. And as he started toward the pulpit, easing along, shuffling his way, he started singing, "What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus." And by the time he got to the pulpit, the whole congregation was standing and they were singing along with him, "Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus." He'd made his point without even hardly opening his mouth. Nothing but the blood. Some years ago, there was a great parliament of religion held in Chicago. All various religions, Eastern religions, Western religions, all different types of religions were represented there in that great parliament of religion. And in one of the sessions, Dr. Joseph Cook of Boston stood up and he said, "Let me ask you a question. There's a woman here that's in need. There's a woman here that has blood on her hands. There's a woman here that has committed murder. And she's desperate. She's in agony. She does not know where to go. She's at the point of taking her own life. Is there something that you can say to her? Any of you have a word from her for her that can help her in her desperate situation? She's just about to, at her end of the rope." And they were all silent. Eastern religions, the Western religion, other religions, they were all silent. And then Dr. Cook stood up and he said, let's ask John. And he looked toward heaven. And he said, "John the beloved, there's a woman here. Blood is on her hands. It's murder. She needs forgiveness. She needs to be helped. She needs to be redeemed. Is there any word for her? Do you have any word?" And Dr. Cook listened for a moment. And then he said, "Wait a minute. John is speaking. John is speaking." And here's what he said: "The blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth from all sin." All the Eastern religions and the Western cults, and they had no answer for this woman in need. They had no answer for her sin. Listen, the religions of the world have no answer for the sin of mankind. Only the blood of Jesus has the answer. Do you need forgiveness this morning? Do you need to be washed in the blood of the Lamb today? Do you need to be forgiven of sin? I'll tell you, Jesus Christ and His shed blood is the only answer to your situation. He'll forgive, He'll cleanse, He'll transform, make you a new person. Doesn't make any difference what you've done. Doesn't make any difference about your sin. You're not too sinful for God to save. You're not too sinful for God to transform. Makes no difference. God is able.
Hear the bells ringing, they're singing that you can be born again. Hear the bells ringing, they're singing, Christ is risen from the dead. The angel upon the tombstone said he has risen, just as he said. Tell his disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. Joy to the world, he is risen. Hallelujah, he's risen. Hallelujah, he's risen. Receive it, for this could be your glory.